Every dream is born from a passion. Every passion generates a mission. Every mission merits perpetuation. We understand this process linkage, created solutions for financial stability and management, built a company for your dream's fulfillment. Spring Rain Global Consultancy Incorporated. Like rain during springtime, we nourish your dream that it be filled with life. We evaluate your financial capacity at the starting line. We improve your financial literacy over time. We generate your financial blueprint along the way. Help improve projects that are underway. Develop new strategies for financial balance to be attained. Find you, philanthropic partners, who wish your mission be generously sustained. Spring Rain Global Consultancy Incorporated. Nourishing your dreams into fruition and regeneration.
Spring Rain Global Consultancy is a social enterprise answering a critical social need. Religious organizations, schools, and other nonprofit social purpose organizations have good causes and values and valid social missions, but they lack awareness, support, and ultimately, sustainability. Thus, their programs run the risk of getting discontinued should there be a crisis or a sudden change in leadership.
Spring Rain Global addresses this critical social need through innovation, the SRG 6-pillar PDO capacitation model.
Strengthening leadership and governance within the organization. Crafting the organization's vision, mission, and goals, and their guideposts in every action they undertake.
Sharpening their advocacies and enhancing their program development and management systems to ensure that they are truly answering the needs of their constituents and communities.
Organizing philanthropic development offices to grow awareness and consistent, reliable support base for the advocacies and programs.
Developing financial roadmaps to help them attain sustainability and constancy in mission.
Valuing the importance of data in monitoring and assessing impact of their programs and developing and nurturing their relationships with partners and donors.
Connecting them with each other and to donors through an ecosystem of good so they can work collectively, share resources, learn from each other, and ultimately maximize their impact and hopefully achieve their development goals.
We are a value-oriented team comprised of all types of professionals with different areas of expertise, including but not limited to experienced social development workers, registered financial consultants, certified fundraising managers, and business and marketing consultants.
We all work together with a common mission of creating a greater good in every community in which we serve.
Innovative in our approach, we provide the tools and create systems to help organizations stay true to their visions, scale up in their missions, and impact more beneficiaries.
We partner with non-government and civic organizations, religious congregations, schools, and corporations and organize them into philanthropic development offices individually and collectively.
We journey with our PDOs, empowering them to maximize their social impact and sustain their mission.
Through training and consultancy services, utilizing the power of the digital medium to reach more organizations in need of support, we adapt our services to the available resources, manpower, and financial capabilities of our various clients.
Full consultancy services with access to all basic and orientation trainings plus regular coaching and consultancy sessions.
Access to basic trainings only.
On-call consultancy.
Customized or extensive trainings.
and retainership.
Fund facilitation services linking our clients to our network of philanthropists, corporations, and grant-making organizations.
AVPN, WINGS, National University Singapore Society Club, Isla Ventures, Global Impact Investing Network, Alpha Tech, Global Solutions Inc., and Indiana University Indianapolis Fundraising School.
Our other services include outsourced services, graphics and design, grant writing and solicitation letter writing, event management, video production, and website design and management.
Though diverse in experiences, all of us here in Springwind Global are devoted to one call to break cycles of poverty in all its forms.
We believe that systemic change can only occur if the smallest development player who works at the very grassroots of society is empowered.
In our ecosystem of good, we believe that the right people and organizations will come for the same purpose we are all called, and that is to achieve our ultimate goal of sustainability, thus supporting the various advocacies, promoting the social impact of our collective efforts together.
A PDO is a philanthropic development office we consider as the basic unit of the ecosystem where we professionalize the direct linkage between donors and beneficiaries. It will institutionalize and create transparency, good stewardship of resources, monitor impact of their programs, create advocacy impact so that in the holistic part of it, it's not just only about the money, but it's also the stewardship of the utilization of this money that is supporting the mission of these charities. We are also trying to build an ecosystem of different philanthropic development offices because it is only in the ecosystem that we will be able to sustain our growth together.
We see that this PDO thing, this whole ecosystem, social commerce, and crypto philanthropy is the best way forward towards sustainability. Not only for the foundation itself, but also for the beneficiaries who eventually be the ones to receive whatever benefits that the foundation will be receiving. And of course, ultimately, the other PDOs also all over the country.
It has helped us to identify our funding needs, especially for the sick. With the help and guidance that they are giving, our ministry to the sick is now more organized, more efficient, and systematic.
They have been doing their best to assist us and to work from where we are so that we could truly function as such.
One thing that Spring Rain was able to help us and has been going on until now is really connecting a lot of people, and not only here in the Philippines, but also in abroad.
They have given us the right mindset, the skill set, and the tool set that we need in order to establish our office and to raise funds for our apostolate in education.
It was very chaotic before Spring Rain. We were just scrambling and trying to figure things out. Where Spring Rain came and gave us the technology on how to run it properly. We had departments, roles, and it was an organized machine where it's just like a business or any entity that it would function on its own. Even if one person's not there or the president is not there, the foundation is constantly moving and functioning.
For the new PDOs, the resources that you have will be maximized because of the system that Spring Rain will teach you and will share with you.
The system has helped us how to pool resources, how to manage the fund, how also to manage our advocacies, our activities and program, how to sustain it and plans are being done for its continuity.
I would like to invite you to engage with Spring Rain and help the people, your community, more with the system.
Without the system, it will block succession. If you have the right skillful people without the system, then it cannot sustain long enough. If you have a system without the right people, then you miss the opportunity of maximizing the whole process. There's a lot of donor fatigue that is happening right now. And it's not because they don't want to give. It's about being annoyed by the manner of asking. It's actually the manner of the way we are communicating with the donor.
The perennial problem that we have been encountering is the problem of sustainability. Partly because we haven't nourished and nurtured relationships with our different benefactors all these years. That's when I see the great potential that once we are able to connect and to nurture our relationship with our donors and eventually make their donation, make their giving more of a happy experience, then probably things will be better. So that it doesn't become a linear type of relationship, but it becomes a mutual kind of relationship. When the donor gives, he is happy. He is happy because he was able to give. And of course, he is happy that he is being regularly updated by the happenings and the updates of the foundation itself.
We are able to see more people who are really not only business driven, but deep inside, they want to make their businesses even more meaningful. They are finding meaning on giving impact to the lives of others. It ignites more our desire to do mission, to expand our mission. We are very excited to continue doing it and to be more serious about it.
It takes a way to really study them and learn about how these donors need to get motivated, get involved, so that the fatigue that is happening will turn into a transformation of partnership, love, generosity, and it will create a very wonderful family in the world of philanthropy.
Thank you.
grand horizon. 500 years of faith, grateful today. We bear the gift of mission. Totally yours, we give ourselves. Faithfully yours until the end. To your mission, Lord, we give our yes.
Go where the sun rises above the hills. Share the word and serve those who are in need. Let the morning star accompany your way. Spread the fire of mission for the Lord.
We stand before the grand horizon. 500 years of faith, grateful today.
Justice and peace. The sign the world today will come to believe is the love we have on and on.
We bear the gift of mission.
Mercy,
justice and peace.
Good evening, everyone, and also good morning and good afternoon to those who are joining us from other parts of the world. Welcome to the 18th day of Spring Rain Global's 45 days of Lenten spiritual journey and Holy Week, reflections for the grace of the 500 years of Christianity. Before we proceed, may I request everyone to please keep your microphones on mute as you log in and for the whole duration of the program to ensure the solemnity of the recollection. We also encourage you, if you feel that you have been enriched or touched somehow by this daily Lenten habit, to also invite your family and friends to join us in this spiritual journey. We are live every day via Zoom and on Facebook via the Spring Rain Global page. We will now have our opening song followed by the Spring Rain Global prayer.
Oh, In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The Spring Rain Global Prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the opportunity to be called in this noble endeavor of serving people and organizations through our thrust for a deeper love for humanity and stewardship of our giftedness. As we respond to this ministry each day, fill us with the power of the Holy Spirit, that your wisdom may enlighten us, that your strength may remind us to stay focused in our purpose and calling, that your light be our guide at all times, and that your love be in our hearts. We know that the journey may not always be easy, but we firmly believe and hold on to your promise that you will be with us both in our challenges and victories as we bring love and unity to your people in service for others. We continue to pray that as we grow the mission and purpose of our Spring Rain Global family, we may be sustained by your grace, ready to open the path for others, so that your blessings and divine providence may completely flow to each and every one of us. May we always stay in your grace, now and forever. This we ask in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
We will now play the national anthems of the Philippines, U.S., and Singapore to signify the countries where Spring Rain Global is registered and operating.
And the rockets red glare, the bombs.
tonight's speaker will be guiding us in our reflection about the fifth sacrament in the Bible, the sacrament of anointing of the sick. We will be guided in our reflection by Father Edilberto Mahinay, DCM, Dean of Studies of St. Francis Xavier, Regional Major, Seminary of Mindanao, Davao City, Vicar for the Clergy of the Diocese of Mati. Father?
Good evening, good morning, and good day to all of you.
Good day.
Allow me to share screen while I'll be presenting some of the points invited me to share. Allow me to share screen, please.
Yes.
Okay, I don't know if you can see already my my screen.
Yes, Father.
Okay. So there are three parts of my presentation this evening. First part will be about greetings and acknowledgement. And the second part will be the content of the presentation. And the content of the presentation will have four parts. So first part is about the reality of human suffering and the need for healing. And the second part will be the meaning and importance of the sacrament of anointing of the sick. And the third part will be the invitation of the church. And the fourth part of our content will be the points for reflection. And the third general part will be the finale or the closing prayer. So these are the three main parts of my presentation this evening. First is about the greetings and acknowledgement. I would like first to greet all of you. Happy Feast Day of St. Joseph, the husband of Mary. And allow me first to express my gratitude for this invitation to be part of this good initiative of the officers and members of the Spring Rain Global Community. And it is an honor on my part to be included in the list of speakers for these 45 days of Lenten spiritual journey and Holy Week, a beautiful initiative. In time of our celebration of the 500 years of Christianity here in the local church of the Philippines. And personally, I would like also to acknowledge this gesture of Father Victor Gonzaga, OSA, for personally inviting me as one of the sharers during this Lenten time and Holy Week. And I would like to take this opportunity also to welcome each of us here in this virtual conference sharing today, this evening, or tonight. I am assigned to share and reflect on the sacrament of anointing of the sick. I hope and pray that our reflection tonight would remind all of us of the meaning and importance of this sacrament of the church. And secondly, so these are the content of the presentation that I have that I will be presenting. So allow me to just follow this sequence and hopefully we can gain some insights as we go through with these four parts tonight. First, no, and the second main part is about the content. And as I said, we'll be following the sequence. First part, the reality of human suffering and the need for healing. Allow me to present to you these beautiful words stated in the book of Robert G. Schroeder. The book is entitled as John Paul II and the Meaning of Suffering, Lessons from a Spiritual Master. So I would like to use his words, because as I was reflecting for my introductory words for this sharing, I was brought to this beautiful book of Robert, and the introductory part of this book also captured my attention, particularly about these words that he presented at the introductory part of his book. And these are the words presented there. None of us can avoid the sting of suffering, regardless of our age, race, religion, occupation, or IQ. Suffering is always there following us around like a black cloud that rains down misery. It hurts and the ones we love. It shakes our spirit and scandalizes our hope. It reminds us of the evil in our midst and our need for liberation. As people of faith in God who gives meaning to our lives, we struggle with the senselessness of suffering. Suffering doesn't always work like we think it should, striking down the wicked and sparing the good, bending the laws of justice at whim. Suffering victimizes who it wants to. Even the most innocent among us, without hesitation or conscience. Such absurdity often leaves us wanting for any black and white explanations for our pain. And it seems the more we try to unravel suffering's mysterious ways, the more they slip through our mind's grasp and elude our search for meaning. Yet our hearts still cry out for answers. These words of Robert, the author of that book, brought us really to understand what this human suffering that we are facing every day. And to continue, according to John Paul II in his book, The Loving Heart, page 51. Suffering has made us victims many times over. It can turn our hallelujahs to doubts, our laughs to tears, and our routines to chaos. And in the words of St. John Paul II, when we suffer bodily and spiritually, we enter into new reality that contrasts with our normal way of life. We cross the threshold from how life was without suffering to how life is with suffering. Suffering disrupts our spiritual and physical equilibrium, arrests our concentration, and limits our activities. It is a limitation and an ordeal, a stumbling block on the road to life. It's really true. When each of us is confronted with pain and suffering, it would really affect the totality of our whole being. And it goes really beyond age, culture, color, practices, and beliefs, and even religions. It's a universal reality. And to continue, it is said that as we try, we might to avoid it, suffering often proves too big and powerful, a force to stop, a reality about which sickness and death constantly remind us. It reminds us of really our limitation, or our vulnerability, that every time when it confronts us, all we have to do is to surrender to someone who is divine, who could totally help us. When suffering confronts us, it would leave us really vulnerable to that extent. And John Paul II, Father, said, suffering is a condition of our membership in the human race. It is the universal theme that accompanies man at every point on earth. It coexists with him in the world. It is the daily bread of human beings, the permanent condition of life in every age. As mentioned in the book, Salvifici Doloris, and also Join Your Suffering to Christ, page 46. When we are confronted with this, my dear brothers and sisters, what's our attitude and practice or practices in front of suffering or sickness? We will bring ourselves to how the church understands this reality. So it's now we try to look at suffering from the church's perspective. And according to one church document, Catechism of the Catholic Church, number 1500, illness and suffering have always been among the gravest problems confronted in human life. In illness or suffering, man experiences his powerlessness, his limitations, and his finitude. Every illness can make us glimpse of death. And Catechism of the Catholic Church 1501 also says, illness can lead to anguish, self-absorption, sometimes even despair and revolt against God. It's really true. And in fact, sometimes we bargain, we gamble, because when that time comes, we do not know what we are really exactly doing. When that time comes, since we are caught up with that vulnerability, we do not know what we're going to do. So it can also make a person more mature, helping him discern in his life what is most essential so that he can turn toward that which is. Very often, illness provokes a search for God and a return to him. And the experience of grave illness or suffering brings about a crisis of our relation with ourselves and others. We experience our limits, our freedoms, our faults, and can also experience a movement of grace. So, what are these crises that illness or suffering would give us, would bring us? First, it's about crisis of our relation with ourselves. The mind, body, soul harmony is broken. When we are physically disturbed, it would affect our whole being. Even if we have just a simple wound on our body parts. For example, if one hand is wounded, we do not only experience the pain on that body part, but it would affect our whole being. So when one is experiencing suffering or illness, he would be experiencing this crisis of relationship with himself. So the mind and body, the soul harmony is broken. Crisis of relation with others because of suffering or illness, pains or struggles. Sometimes we do not want to mingle with people. We want to isolate, or perhaps because of these illnesses or suffering, it would be deliberate sometimes or perhaps many times that we will be separated, we will be isolated. And when we are brought to that extent, that's the time that we feel the crisis, that as if we are alone and abandoned, can no longer socialize, work, play, becomes isolated and marginalized. And because of this, we feel that crisis within us. And at the same time, it would be an experience of our limits, shows our human limits of mortality. It reminds us of our being mortals. My death becomes a very real, concrete possibility, not simply an abstract concept. When, especially if you are experiencing already that excruciating pain, that's the time that we feel so abandoned, that we feel also being alone and as if nobody is taking care of us. And in fact, you can relate. Many would question God why this happens to them. It also limits our freedom. Our body is no longer disposed to our will. We can no longer do as we desire. We become inactive and dependent on others. And it would also somehow motivate us to find faults of other people. We blame people because of what we have experienced. When grave and deep suffering would come to us, there are times that we blame people and we find faults of other people. Sickness can be perceived as our fault, but sometimes people are the ones accused that they are the faults of what we have experienced. But in reality, it is our fault because we believe that it's a consequence of sin that we have committed. But at the same time, when this confronts us, we also realize that it's a time and a moment of grace. Why? Because for many, especially for those who have tried to accept pain and suffering in their lives, they are brought instead to be more closer to the Lord. Yes, they experience pain and suffering or illnesses, but those moments are also understood as moments of grace, because instead of isolating themselves, instead of finding themselves alone and abandoned, all the more they experience that they are so close to the Lord. But despite of this, my dear brothers and sisters, because of these perennial experiences of suffering, this brought humanity really to us. And perhaps you can relate also to these questions. Why does a loving God allow us to suffer? Did we do something to deserve our suffering? Does our pain serve any purpose in God's plan? Or can faith give us any reasons to hope? Excuse me. These are questions that rack our minds and jab at our souls. They press down hard on us to respond and leave us wondering. Are there any real answers that can help us cope with the trials and tribulations of yesterday, today, and tomorrow? And John Paul II, again, in mentioned in Gaudium et Spes also, and in his book, Salvifici Dolores, gave us the affirmative answer about our understanding of human suffering. And he said, we can indeed find meaning in suffering, provided we look for it in the treasury of divine wisdom, fully revealed in Jesus Christ, as the Second Vatican Council has stated, only in Jesus. When we are confronted with pain and suffering and illness or diseases, only in Jesus do the riddles of sorrow and death grow meaningful. This Christian conviction of faith sheds light on the deep mystery of suffering, means that it is right for us to seek answers in hope. For only in searching we can find the gospel or the good news that Jesus' life, death, and resurrection give saving meaning to our many sufferings in this life. So despite of these confrontations of pain and suffering, of diseases and illnesses that brought us somehow to experience of despair and absurdities, yet when we relate sufferings in the context of our spiritual life, that's the time that we can find even just a glimpse of what we hope for. Finding and relating our pain and suffering in the very person of Jesus Christ. But it's also good for us to be founded on our understanding of human suffering. It is also good for us to go back to the biblical understanding of human suffering. We go first to the understanding in the Old Testament about sickness. And it is said that in the Old Testament, suffering is always seen in relation to religion and faith. It is not an isolated event. From the very beginning, there is seen a link between suffering, sickness, and sin. For example, Eve's pain of childbirth following original sin. Sickness was seen as a punishment for sin. However, the problem of the experience of innocent suffering provoked a search for a deeper meaning. How about those innocent children who died? And we try to understand that they have not committed any sins. Why they experience as such? That is why it confronted us again, finding answers to this reality. If suffering, sickness, is a consequence of sin, how about those who die early? If one was personally innocent, perhaps his suffering was due to his solidarity with a simple community. With the prophets, the time of God's justice was pushed into the future and eventually into the eschatological future with the messianic expectations. It is somehow understood as, yes, it's an experience here and now as part of humanity's journeys here on earth. But at the same time, it leads humanity to think, particularly if we connect this in the context of our spiritual life, connect this in the very person of Jesus. There is something that we can hold on that would bring us to see where it would be leading us. And that's the time that we can connect our human experiences of pain and suffering to eternal dimension. When humanity experiences pain and suffering, that's also the time that humanity would be led to think and to anchor on something divine, until such a time that it would become redeemed on his part. The book of Job deals with this problem on meaning of suffering and shows various views or attempts to explain. For example, sickness as punishment, according to the book of Job, suffering as purifying, or suffering as an invitation to trust God and his mystery. If we're going to read the book of Job, the readers will be brought to realize about this reality of how humanity would understand pain and suffering. And according to these interpretations, the book of Job is presenting to us the reality of pain and suffering and how humanity would also be elevated when his pain and suffering would be connected or will be offered to God and to trust in his mystery. That's somehow from the Old Testament perspective. Now we go in the New Testament perspective. Jesus certainly manifests compassion for the sick and suffering, seen especially in his many cures. Yet, he does not search, if you're going to go back to the Gospels and the miracles performed by Jesus, we could notice one thing. He does not search out those who are sick to cure them, as if this is the central mission of Jesus while preaching about the kingdom, that is to cure the sick. No. It's not the central mission of Jesus, because the central message is about the kingdom and God's mercy. And his healings are signs of the authenticity of his mission and of the kingdom. So while he is telling us about the kingdom and about God's mercy, that's also the time that Jesus shows to us his compassion and mercy to those who are sick and suffering. And because of this, many sick persons approach him and ask him for healing. So it is not the primary reason of his coming, but the primary reason of his coming is to tell us and to preach about the kingdom and God's mercy. But in doing this, he is at the same time presenting to us, showing to us this constitutive reality, of his mercy and compassion and healing. So it is not therefore separated from the central message of Jesus about the kingdom. It is a constitutive reality that in part, we can see that the very center of Jesus' ministry is about the kingdom. But that image of the kingdom is an image of God's mercy, God's compassion for his people. And this leads us to understand that healing is a constitutive reality. And so, we can somehow elaborate this, what Jesus showed to us during his public ministry. And it is said, although he does not specifically seek out the sick, he cures all who would come to him, not simply for the cure, but as a sign of presence of the kingdom, which invites a response, an invitation to deeper faith. Secondly, his healings are generally in the context of faith, inviting the sick person to make an act of faith. Now, if we're going to go back, perhaps all of us can relate, no, the miracles that Jesus performed, particularly healing miracle. He would always ask the person, your faith has saved you. Your faith has cured you. Your sins are forgiven because of your faith. So there's always a connection that the person who is healed is invited at the same time to grow in his faith. Because faith for Jesus is about faith of the kingdom. Faith about the message of the kingdom. That is why we could say, as mentioned earlier, it is a constitutive reality. The message of the kingdom could be understood also as a message of healing. Healing about human pains and suffering, which is a constitutive reality of the kingdom of God and the expression of the mercy of God. So beautiful, my dear brothers and sisters. And immediately we can make somehow a kind of conclusion here, though we will be mentioning about this later. So it would invite us immediately that if we come to Jesus, if we embrace Jesus into our lives, it would really bring us total healing, not only about our physical healing, but healing of body and soul. That is why it is mentioned here in this slide. The culmination of his mission is not suffering, but his solidarity with suffering men, not in his death, but in his death and resurrection that destroy the power of death and restore for us to life. Jesus' concern is for total healing, not simply physical healing. Why? Because as mentioned, it is a constitutive reality of the message of the kingdom. And salvation is all about the totality of the person. Salvation, or the redeeming action of Christ, is shown to us not only to heal our physical infirmities, but in reality, it is an experience of physical and spiritual healing. And so, again, as mentioned, immediately we can make a kind of conclusion that if we approach and embrace Jesus into our lives, this would really bring no particular impact, no? Change of heart, change of our whole being. It would really be an experience of metanoia. It would change the movement of our lives. No, just like a 360 experience of God's accompaniment and journeying with us in and through Jesus. But to understand further about this presentation, my dear brothers and sisters, allow me to proceed to the second part of the content of this presentation, the meaning and the importance now of the sacrament of the anointing of the sick. The sacrament of the anointing of the sick brings an experience of solidarity with others and actualizes this solidarity with Christ and his church, who suffered and died, but in so doing, made suffering redemptive and destroyed death once and for all. So the sacrament of the anointing of the sick, when we talk about meaning and importance of the sacrament, it would really lead us to that important point of reference. And who is that? Jesus Christ. When our suffering is related to Jesus Christ, it would become redemptive. Why? Because it's already Jesus who heals, who helps us through his redeeming action expressed through the Paschal mystery, his passion, death, and resurrection. And so, uniting our sufferings with that of Christ in his Paschal mystery, our suffering would become redemptive, because the action of Christ through his Paschal mystery is redemptive. And because of this, it helps us make up for what is lacking in the sufferings of Christ. So, when we talk about the meaning and importance of the sacrament of the anointing of the sick, particularly in telling this to people, to our faithful in the church today, inviting them to acknowledge the importance of this sacrament, hopefully of all us will be brought to that important point of convergence, that it is really through the redemptive and the redeeming action of Christ that pain and suffering would become redemptive. Though at the start, it would lead us to ask ourselves, because of that experience of so excruciating, that it would change and destroy the equilibrium of our whole being. But when it is related to Christ, it would really bring us to right perspective and right journey of our life, despite of the pain and suffering, because it is already the Lord, it is already Jesus who is carrying our pain and suffering. It is already Jesus who is journeying with us through this pain and suffering that he also shared and offered through his Paschal mystery. And so, after Jesus, the church also confronts sickness and continues of Jesus' attitude of compassion towards those who are sick. And this can be seen in three aspects. That is why it becomes also constitutive in the very image of the church. If it is constitutive in the proclamation of the kingdom of God, and if it is constitutive in the show, in the expression of God's mercy, and so it would also become, and it becomes, the constitutive image of the church today. The church has to see to it the importance of the sacrament of the anointing of the sick, and where it would be inculcated, where the church can image this one through the expression of her charism as a healing image. The church must become a healing image. And healing would become a charism of the church. Healing is seen as a sign that accompanies the gospel message of integral salvation. The church has to continue telling the world. Why? Because it forms part of the very nature of the church now. Because according to Lumen Gentium number 1, the church is in Christ. The church is in Christ. So when it is understood as such, therefore, the church becomes a radical sacrament. And when the church becomes a radical sacrament, it would always continue to show that beautiful image of the presence of Christ to the people in the world. And so the church has to image always this charism because it becomes constitutive image of the church. Number two, just like the disciples anointed and healed, the church has to continue this mission of anointing and healing when it becomes her charism. It would also lead the church to anoint and to heal people. And Father, it would be your expression of love. So it would not only become a charism of the church, a charism that anoints and heals people, but at the same time, it must always an expression of church love or charity. It would, the church has to express this image to sick people, to those who are experiencing pain and suffering. And this must be, according to this light, this must be a criterion, an important image of the church. And in fact, when the church started from the very beginning, it's always seen as an important image, particularly to those who are really suffering. And so, again, we are brought here to find already the meaning and the importance of the sacrament of the anointing of the sick. Why? Because it is Jesus Christ who showed this through his redeeming action. And because the church is in Christ, and Christ is in the church, and so the church has to continue showing this image until such a time that this would always become a constitutive image of the church, an image of healing, an image of anointing and healing, an image of love that would tell and that would bring the people who are experiencing pain and suffering into her embrace. That's the church has to do and has to tell to the people today. But it's also good too, because there are a lot of people who ask today, especially in contemporary questions, asking us, do we have biblical foundations of anointing of the sick? And so we have two texts here coming from the Gospel of Mark and also from the letter of James. And it is said that although this text does not show the institution of the sacrament, it does attest to a general praxis in apostolic times of the anointing of the sick with oil. Because the text coming from the Gospel of Mark says, Jesus sent the 12 out 2 by 2. They drove out many demons, and they anointed with oil many who were sick and cured them. And also the letter of James tells us in chapter 5, verses 14 and 15, is anyone among you sick? He should summon the presbyters of the church, and he should pray over him and anoint him with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer of faith will save the sick person, and the Lord will raise him up. If he has committed any sins, he will be forgiven. It's good for us to go back to a short explanation about this text, particularly the letter of James. It is said, The exact meaning of presbyter is unclear, but in context, it clearly refers to some kind of leader in the church. The passage lists the two elements as prayer and anointing with oil. And the text also stated the fruits or effects of this practice, this expression of the church during his time. And what are the effects of this? The prayer of the community will save. The Lord will raise him up, and his sins will be forgiven. And this could be interpreted, these 3 points could be interpreted in two senses. It is terrestrial, meaning to say conventional of here and now, but at the same time eschatological, because the practice of anointing of the sick does not or would not only heal the physical part of the person, but it also heals the spiritual. That is why it is called terrestrial or eschatological. So while the gravity of the illness is not mentioned, it appears to be serious enough that the person cannot go to the presbyters but needs to summon them. So there is also the presence of presbyters as mentioned in the letter of James. So an ordained minister, as it is understood today, has also an important role in the anointing of the sick. Okay. So we are, through this text coming from the Gospel of Mark and from the letter of James, we are told that from the very beginning of the church, there already exists this understanding that it forms part of the very image of the church. And so it tells us of that word that we mentioned earlier. It is also a constitutive reality, a constitutive image of the church. Since the church is in Christ, and the very point of convergence in understanding the sacrament of the anointing of the sick is the redeeming action of Christ. And so it's always, and it must be, an expression of the church. Vatican II also captures this one, captures the meaning of the anointing of the sick. Though there is I will not focus on the historical development of this, but on the theological presentation according to Vatican II. And Vatican II tells us again of the importance and about the sacrament of the anointing of the sick, also mentioned in Sacrosanctum Concilium number 73 and Sacrosanctum Concilium number 74 in the documents of Vatican II. So we have the new rite now of the anointing of the sick, the one rite that we follow in the church today. And the rite presents to us the fundamental elements of the sacrament. And what are these two fundamental elements of the sacrament of anointing? It's about the recipient and the rite. The recipient, since the sacrament is seen as a strength in time of crisis and a participation in the suffering of Christ, the recipient of this sacrament is a person facing a grave illness, is not reserved to only those in imminent danger of death as in the past. The purpose is to help the person live a Christian life, even in the face of the crisis of sickness. And for this reason, it can be repeated. That is why if the sick person wants to have another anointing of the sick, it could be done, because that's how it is accepted ang presented to us according to the practice and how it is understood in the church, according to the fundamentals of the anointing of the sick. And the normal minister is the priests. The rite consists of three elements: the community, the prayer, and the anointing itself. So when we talk about the community, the priest represents the larger community. So every time the sacraments of the anointing is celebrated, there's a need of the presence of the community. That is why the priest who is doing the anointing of the sick would always ask members of the family or friends, relatives who are close to the sick person to come and offer prayer in solidarity to the sick person. So the priest there, the minister, represents the community, also giving importance to the word of God. The prayer, the second element, in addition to the prayers of the gathered community, intercession, Lord's Prayer, there is the sacramental formula. And through this holy anointing, you know, the putting already of oil on the forehead and on the palms of the sick person, this prayer is addressed directly to the sick person and indirectly to God, asking him for the grace of the Holy Spirit in order to forgive sins, save the person, and raise the person up. Thus, the emphasis was on the forgiveness of sins as a preparation for death and the actual anointing of the sick. And the importance also of this part or of this element, the anointing with oil, signifies physically what it causes spiritually. Healing and anointing with oil was a common Jewish remedy. But the relation between the anointing and the prayer can be seen in two ways. First, the prayer can be seen as providing the significance to the more important element of anointing, and the anointing of oil gives significance to the prayer and help understand what happens in the prayer. And so, in the rite of the anointing of the sick, the minister, we as priests, should never forget to follow the sequence of these three important elements of the anointing of the sick. Now we proceed to the third part, the invitation of the church. And we will be brought to realize that the church, through her mission, is always consistent about this work of redemption. So it's a beautiful, it's really, you know, as a priest, I just would like, before presenting some points here, it's always an amazing experience for me as a priest. Every time I would do anointing of the sick, because there's always this sense of joy that I would feel, you know, personally. Every time I would do anointing of the sick, there's this experience of a different kind of joy that I feel within me, within my heart. I just really don't know why. And perhaps it's because it's part of my ministry, of our ministry as priests. What's the invitation of the church for all of us, my dear brothers and sisters? If it is a work of redemption, so we have going to understand this from the theological perspective. So this image of the church, this invitation of the church rather, follows according to what the church has to continually show who are faithful up until today. And according to Colossians 1:24, now I rejoice in my sufferings for your sake. And in my flesh, I am filling up what is lacking in the afflictions of Christ on behalf of his body, which is the church. By uniting our suffering with that of Christ, the sufferings become salvific. Our sufferings help us further extend the salvation he won once for all to his body, the church, in every age and place. So the sacrament of anointing of the sick gives us the grace to do this by uniting us to the sacrament, to the suffering Christ in his Paschal mystery. So what does this mean? It means that the church, since it's a constitutive reality, sacrament of the anointing of the sick is a constitutive reality of the beautiful image of the church. Whatever humanity experiences, particularly pain and suffering, the church has to fill in that gap through her mission. So now, and through the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, the church has to fill in the experience of vacuum, that experience of gap because of pain and suffering. The church has to bring the people to be connected to the church in order for the people to experience always this redeeming action of Christ in the church, so that the health, that broken relationship of body and soul will be healed, that disruption of harmony in the individual because of suffering will be harmonized, will be healed, and the abandoned, the isolated individuals will be in communion already with the church. And at the same time, he or she will be brought to experience this redeeming action of Christ. So because of pain and suffering, as we mentioned earlier, the individual seemingly is brought outside the church. But because of the anointing of the sick, which becomes constitutive nature of the church, the individual, the sick and the suffering individuals will be brought back into the church through the church's expression of the sacrament of the anointing of the sick. That's how beautiful, that's how meaningful the sacrament of the anointing of the sick, because it would bring the individual who is experiencing suffering, really the totality of an experience of God's healing and redemption. It would bring the individual to experience again the message of the kingdom through the church who is performing the sacrament of the anointing of the sick. And so how and what would the individual would experience? The mercy of Jesus Christ, the revelation of the mercy of Jesus Christ, though he or she is sick. But when the sacrament is performed, when the sacrament is celebrated, though caught up with that reality, the individuals would experience the mercy of God being revealed into him or into her through the church. So it is God's mercy. It is God who is rich in mercy, whom Jesus has revealed to us as Father, It is His very Son who in Himself has manifested Him and made Him known to us. Memorable in this regard is the moment when Philip, now we have this in the Gospel, when Philip, one of the 12 apostles, turned to Christ and said, "Lord, show us the Father, and we shall be satisfied." And Jesus replied to Philip, "Have I have been with you so long, and yet you do not know me? He who has seen me has seen the Father." These words were spoken during the farewell discourse at the end of the Paschal Supper, which was followed by the events of those holy days, during which confirmation was to be given once and for all of the fact that God, who is rich in mercy, out of the great love with which He loved us, even when we were dead through our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. For this reason, it is now fitting to reflect on this mystery. It is called for by the varied experiences of the church and of the contemporary men. It is also demanded by the pleas of many human hearts, their sufferings and hopes, their anxieties and expectations. In Jesus Christ, every path to man, as it has been assigned once and for all to the church, in the changing of times, is simultaneously an approach to the Father and His love. The church, yes, is invited, but at the same time, the church is inviting us, particularly ministers of the church, to continually show this to people confronted with this human reality of pain and suffering, in order for them to continually also experience the healing and the redeeming action of Christ in the church. This is an important invitation of the church for all of us. Today, as we insiders in the church, have to help the church show this to the world. This is the invitation of the church today. Yes, the church is invited by the Lord. See, since she is in Christ, and the church is in Christ, it is a constitutive reality of the church. And so the church has to show and continually show this commitment to her faithful in order for them to experience the mercy of God in Christ through the ministers who will be performing the sacrament of the anointing of the sick. It's a beautiful invitation of the church for all of us. The truth revealed in Christ about God, the Father of mercies, enables us to see Him as particularly close to man, especially when man is suffering, when he is under the threat at the very heart of his existence and dignity. Because when man suffers, there's always this tendency for him to ask God, "Where is God?" But when this person who is suffering can see in the church and her mission, telling him about the redeeming action of Christ, it would really bring always that person to experience the love and the mercy of God in Christ, despite all. Even in our common experiences, my dear brothers and sisters, even simple pain and suffering, when we relate this to Christ, there's always an experience of joy. There's always this sense of fulfillment. There's always this sense of happiness that money can buy, that the world cannot offer, because it is something spiritual. And it is that kind of healing that it is only Christ who can do this to us. And that's his redeeming action shared to us, his Paschal mystery. The points for reflection for all of us today. I believe that Jesus Christ, our Lord, has touched us and healed us in many ways. Because of these experiences of healing, how can we also become instruments of healing to people around us today? People who are deeply threatened with different phases of suffering. The wars between Ukraine and Russia up until this time are causing humanity to suffer. How can we help them? How can we express our communion with people who are suffering? In the context of the seminary, I would like to share this experience. A few days ago, we have this seminarian who is brought to the hospital because of that particular illness about his kidney. And in fact, no, he was operated already. And as a formator here, I cannot just simply ignore this experience of pain and suffering of this individual. And as a formator, I cannot do, even if I am not a priest, I am not a minister of the church, and even if I am not a formator here, I think it would become an expression of, even in my simple way, as a Christian, as a brother. And I think that would already give something to this seminarian. How much more if I'm going to do this as a minister of the church, as a priest of the church, as a formator, as a companion, and we bring this into a bigger reality of the world today. A lot of people, and perhaps I think we are also undergoing pain and suffering as we listen to this sharing about the anointing of the sick. We are at the same time experiencing this excruciating pain that threatens us. And so, despite of this, how can we become instruments of healing to people around us, as we say, who are deeply threatened with different phases of suffering? And as insiders of the church, as ministers of the church, let us help the church become faithful and consistent with this mission and ministry of healing and reconciliation entrusted to her by becoming faithful to our commitment and tasks. I heard only little about your community, the Spring Rain Global Community. And as I listened earlier during the introductory part and about the mission and vision of this community, it gives me an insight that what you are doing is really an expression of charity and love to people who are experiencing different phases of suffering. I would salute to all of you of what you are doing. And hopefully, with the grace of God, we will continue to hold to this commitment, inspired by the Spirit of the Lord, and also as we continue to experience the redeeming action of Christ within us. Thank you, Paul. Thank you, Paul.
Thank you.
closing prayer. Allow me to read Psalm 102, verses 1 to 12. And according to the book of Psalm, this is a prayer of the one afflicted when he is faint and pours out his complaint before the Lord. And I just would like to read this psalm, and you can pray with me with this. Hear my prayer, O Lord. Let my cry come to you. Do not hide your face from me in the day of my distress. Incline your ear to me. Answer me speedily in the day when I call. For my days pass away like smoke, and my bones burn like a furnace. My heart is struck down like grass and withered. I forgot to eat my bread. Because of my loud groaning, my bones cleave to my flesh. I am a vulture of the wilderness, like an owl of waste places. I lie awake. I am like a lonely bird on the housetop. All the day my enemies taunt me. Those who deride me use my name for a curse. For I eat ashes like bread and mingle tears with my drink. Because of your indignation and anger, for you have taken me up and thrown away. My days are like an evening shadow. I withered away like grass. But you, O Lord, are enthroned forever. Your name endures to all generations. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.
As it was in the beginning, now and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
Do I need to give the final blessing, please?
Thank you so much, Father Loy, for your reflection and sharing.
Please, Father Loy, please, for the final blessing.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
And the almighty God bless you. The Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. God bless.
God bless, Father Loy. Salamat kayo.
Thank you, Father Loy. Jesus came to heal the broken, whole person, body, and soul. The sacrament of the anointing of the sick, according to Father Loy, is a charism of the church, an image of love and hope, that if it is in God's will, the person be physically healed of illness of body and soul. But if there is no physical healing, the primary effect of the sacrament is a spiritual healing by which the sick person receives the Holy Spirit's gift of peace and courage to deal with the difficulties that accompany serious illness or the frailty of old age. Luke chapter 5:0-31, Jesus said, "It is not those who are well who need a physician, but those who are sick." Sometimes we easily judge people as sinners and we try to avoid contact with them. On the other hand, we can be that person sent by God to help them be healed. Because Jesus seeks sinners and wants everyone to go back to the Father. In Mark chapter 17, verse 25-27, it is written, "Teacher, I brought you my son possessed with a spirit which makes him mute." Jesus rebuked the unclean spirit, saying to it, "You deaf and mute spirit, I command you, come out of him and do not enter him again." It came out and the boy became so much like a corpse that most of them said, "He's dead." But Jesus took him by the hand and raised him, and he got up. It is in this reading that we see how the evil spirit even obeyed to Jesus. The sacrament of the anointing of the sick is a salvific action. We all can help our suffering brothers and sisters. Yet we need to evoke the Holy Spirit to give us that strong faith to heal us or that person we pray for be healed, both in body and soul. We believe in the gospel. We believe in miracles. And we believe we or that person suffering can be healed. Thank you everyone for joining us this evening. May we request everyone to turn on their cameras for our picture taking.
Please open your cameras. Okay, 1, 2, 3, smile. One more, 1, 2, 3, smile. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Miss Nicole. Please join us again tomorrow, 8 p.m. Philippine time, here at Zoom or live via the Spring Rain Global Facebook page for the 19th day of Spring Rain Global's 45 days of Lenten spiritual journey and Holy Week. Reflections for the grace of the 500 years of Christianity. Tomorrow's topic is the sixth sacrament of the church, the sacrament of matrimony. This will be rendered to us by Mr. Nilo Lastimosa, system test engineer at Agilent Technologies. We hope that you will invite your family and friends, and together let us nurture our faith, love, and devotion to the Lord. As we play our closing song, we bid good night to everybody watching from the Philippines and good day to all those watching from other parts of the world. Thank you and see you again tomorrow. May God bless us all.
And I will be saved. Heal me, O Lord, and I will be healed. For you are the one I praise. You are the one I praise.
Sing it with me.
Heal me, O Lord, and I will be healed. Save me, and I will be saved. Oh, heal me, O Lord, and I will be healed. For you are the one I praise. You are the one I praise.
Jeremiah 17:14. Says, heal me, O Lord, and I will be healed. Save me, and I will be saved, for you are my praise. Nobody would doubt if Jesus touched you at this moment that you would be healed. You know, the same power is inherent in God's word. When His word touches you, it brings healing. His word will not return void, but it will accomplish the purpose for which it's sent. He sent His word and healed us. Let's sing it back to Him and let His healing come as we sing it. Heal me, Lord.
Heal me, O Lord, and I will be healed. Save me, and I will be saved. Oh, heal me,
Thank you so much, Father.
Thank you, everyone.